Welcome to the opening session of the first Dutch virtual trade mission. More than 100 companies from the US and the Netherlands in smart and e-mobility will connect online this week through webinars and online networking sessions and an online platform. The Consulate General of the Netherlands here in San Francisco hosts many trade delegations each year. And all that has been halted by the COVID-19 travel and health restrictions. Through this virtual trade mission, we'll try to bring California and the Netherlands close together from the comfort of everybody's home. Let me introduce the participants of this opening session. First, in Sacramento, California, Eleni Kounalakis, Lieutenant Governor of California. She served as the U.S. Ambassador in Hungary in the Barack Obama administration and has been appointed by Governor Newsom as his representative for international affairs and trade development. And we have Sigrid Kaag, Minister for Foreign Trade and Development Cooperation. She has visited California in last year, and I'm happy to see her again during this opening session. And of course, Consul General Gerbert Kunst. He is the Consul General of the Netherlands in San Francisco, representing the 13 most Western states. Gerbert, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much, Sietse, and a warm welcome to our speakers, Minister Sigrid Kaag and Lieutenant Governor Eleni Kounalakis. This is the first Netherlands virtual mission, and it's for me and for the whole team in San Francisco a very special moment. We are very happy that we are able to organize this from California. And we've learned that this is also a first for the Californian government. I think this opening of the virtual mission is an excellent moment to show the importance of continuing our international relations. And Minister Kaag, I would like to give the floor to you.
I'm delighted to be here. I know we have a time difference, but I think neither distance nor time zones actually separate us from this shared goal to kickstart a new type of mission in this very challenging environment in which we're all about to continue to conduct our business and find new ways of achieving the business models, the collaborative forms in which we can really construct our tremendous collaboration. While sort of thinking of this digital trade mission, we were also, of course, reminded of the Global Entrepreneurship Summit that we were allowed to host in last year in The Hague, in the Netherlands. And it's also a testament and testimony to the strong friendship, partnership, the collaboration that we cherish so much with our friends from the United States at government level, at state level, and of course, business to business. So I'm delighted we're here to discuss trade, to discuss sustainability, and of course to find ways together to really build back better. And the economy, of course, is the backbone of all our endeavors. We've all known and seen now how much COVID-19 can have a negative impact on developed economies such as the United States and ourselves. We have the means to withstand and to sort of bounce back. But as we look at global trade, and we're all dependent on our ability to trade across the globe in so many different countries, it's important that we also assess, of course, the vulnerabilities in our international trading systems, that we assess the value chains and where we can reinforce the chains so that the weakest link becomes the strongest link and the entire chain from private business, the employers and the employees and countries that we stand to gain from this. And that's why I'm delighted to actually open with you, Lieutenant Governor, this first ever digital trade mission that we are sort of co-hosting, because it has advantages too. I think it speaks to the time. We're trying to lighten our carbon footprint. We're trying to make the most of a difficult situation. And of course, Silicon Valley is where we launched Holland in the Valley last year when I visited. Silicon Valley speaks for innovation, creativity, technology, and the way forward. And in that spirit, I think that we want to launch today and really leave our footprint in terms of co-creation, new solutions, at times of corona, but really towards sustainability and inclusive value chains where companies and technology have such a tremendous role to play. So I'm all about excitement here smart and e-mobility and the themes of the seminar are so effective. And I know that we signed last year a number of letters of intent. I certainly hope that this year's new format will produce new forms of partnership, cooperation, and of course, collaboration between the different companies. And I think both you and I look forward to hearing of the results that are both tangible and forward-looking when it comes to business, 21st century, in Corona, but also looking at the era post-Corona. Thanks again to everyone joining us, and over to you, I believe, Lieutenant General. Thank you.
Well, thank you so much, Minister, and I am grateful for your words on keep on building bridges. That is, of course, very important in these times, and I'm thankful for your launch last year of the Holland in the Valley Network. I think this is a perfect example of this effort. And now I would like to introduce Lieutenant Governor of California, Eleni Kounalakis. And Lieutenant Governor, the floor is yours.
Well, thank you very much, Consul General Kunst. It's wonderful to be with you. Of course, it's wonderful to see you again, Minister Koff, and to be with you virtually. It was fabulous to have you in California, and I look forward to seeing you again soon. This is an extraordinary event. And I applaud the efforts of everyone involved in order to create what is certainly a first for us in California, our very first participation in a virtual trade show. I understand it's a first for you. It may be one of the first in the world, and it may also very well be a sense of what is to come. And truly, noted, Madam Minister, the carbon footprint of this event is much less than if we were all together. But of course, we have to make the most of being together virtually and recognize that that it is different and it requires all of us giving it that extra effort in order to be able to make the connections, create new opportunities, and possibly, hopefully, even close some deals. So I'd like to start with some comments on where California stands with our economic recovery effort and what trade and foreign direct investment mean to the California economy. It is our first priority to do everything possible to provide for the health, safety, and well-being of all Californians. And that means doing everything possible to prevent the spread of COVID-19 and in particular, protecting the most vulnerable here in California. As we continue to recover from the COVID-19 pandemic, and as we take deliberative, measured steps to reopen our economy with public health officials, we see an opportunity to support and encourage a green recovery. The scale of the pandemic and the pandemic-induced recession we are all working to address compel us to consider the world we want to build as we recover. As we move forward, it means ensuring an economic recovery that improves public health, reduces inequality, and accelerates climate action. The natural reflex of the immediate public health crisis as it passes, there may be a reflex to go back to the way things were. Yet the scientific evidence has been clear for many years that the global economic status quo is unsustainable. The accelerating climate crisis and rising levels of inequity within our societies pose very real threats to our long-term security, prosperity, public health, and I would argue even our democracies. Environmental degradation increases the chances of future pandemics. Polluted air causes respiratory problems that make people more vulnerable to disease. Rising sea levels and climate-related disasters poses serious danger to cities around the world. During times of crisis, it is always the most vulnerable in our society who bear the heaviest burden. This is precisely why strong leadership and collaboration with trusted partners will help us to shape the future we want in the aftermath of the pandemic, a future that works for everyone. Minister Koch, I know you have called for investing in a green economy, assisting vulnerable communities, and for adopting transparent, participatory, and accountable community-driven solutions. We are honored to count the Netherlands as one of California's longstanding partners with whom we share such a similar vision and commitment toward building back better. California and the Netherlands have long collaborated in the areas of sustainable mobility, including smart charging, urban transportation planning, and zero emission transportation. We have signed a number of MOUs between our governments to further that collaboration, which is very important. And it was my great pleasure to welcome Deputy Prime Minister LaPierre, who you just heard from, to California last November. But you can also assess the impact of our shared commitment to these issues by looking at the economic data. Like the Netherlands, California is heavily dependent on international trade and investment. And we know that our international engagement is critical to our recovery efforts. California is the second largest exporter to the Netherlands among the US states. And in the past 12 months alone, the Netherlands has bought over $143 million in electric vehicles from our state. Yay, thank you. With regard to FDI, Dutch investment provides nearly $1.3 billion in wages to California workers. Dutch firms employ more than 15,000 people in California, and over 35% of those jobs are in manufacturing, an industry of tremendous importance to our workforce, given the potential for upskilling and reskilling that we can support in that sector. Because now, more than ever, we need to support our workforces and to create inclusive, equitable access to the industries of the future. We are aware of these things, and we are very grateful for our partnership between California and the Netherlands and all of the economic activity and support for California workers that it brings. Thank you. Minister Koch, you and I have the duty and responsibility to help our communities recover from an unprecedented crisis and to ensure that our commitment to a more sustainable path forward is not lost amid other priorities, but instead serves as part of the bedrock to the entirety of our recovery response. I know we can do it, you know we can do it, and that is a very big part of why we are here today and why this conference is so important. Thank you.
That you're really underscoring that our partnership works. And I'd like to continue with a few questions. And of course, you're more than welcome to respond to each other. And the first question, I think you've touched upon that one, is regarding the COVID-19 outbreak and its impact on entrepreneurs. So how are the Netherlands and California supporting international entrepreneurs in light of the COVID-19 outbreak? And what specific measures are in place to ensure that companies can weather the storm and can take advantage of the market opportunities of a recovering economy? And I would like to start with you, Lieutenant Governor. Could you maybe elaborate a bit on this question?
Absolutely. So we are very well aware in California of our reliance on international trade and investment. In fact, there are about 800,000 jobs in our state that are here as a result of foreign direct investment. Every job matters. 800,000 jobs is very substantial. And so we recognize that this is important. And we have always, but particularly with this administration, really reinvested and doubled down on ensuring that we're doing everything possible to attract FDI, to bolster and support our entrepreneurs, and to have them understand that we are here to help. So Governor Newsom and I created a partnership largely because of mutual recognition of the importance of trade, but also because of my background as a former United States ambassador. We now have 3 additional trade desks here in our state, people who are fully dedicated full-time to advancing international trade. Now, in light of COVID, there are other programs and other challenges that we have that we're looking to address. So one of them, of course, is that the federal government has contributed substantial amounts of support for businesses during the crisis. The CARES Act created several programs that are very important to small businesses. One of them is the Paycheck Protection Plan to help small businesses survive. California received about $66 billion in funding through PPP, which is about 13% of the national total. We have worked through our platforms and our communication system to help support small and medium-sized businesses in understanding the resources that have been created through the CARES Act and help them access them and understand what's available. We also have several programs that we're looking to strengthen. One of them is our State Trade Expansion Program, provides expertise and resources to small businesses looking to increase their exports. Again, we are reevaluating how to improve that program in light of the challenges of COVID, including using modern technology to help support efforts and expanding the possibility of doing more trade shows and trade missions while people are frankly still staying at home. As well as working with our ports, California is home to some of the and the largest ports in the United States, including Los Angeles and Long Beach. Enormous amount of forward thinking, creativity, rapid response about what we can do in light of COVID to help support businesses in their efforts to export, and even looking at some onshoring of supply chain in order to create more certainty in the, and predictability in those supply chains in light of the fact that there were additional vulnerabilities that were exposed during COVID and still continue to be. We also are looking to continue to expand our virtual export promotion services. We are becoming more and more creative, as are you, in trying to figure out how do we find those companies that have the capacity for export and connect them with markets. And so those are some of the programs we're doing. I should note that California is working with Western states in very aggressively arguing for additional foreign aid, additional aid from the federal government to promote foreign trade, but also to help with some of the bedrock elements of supporting the California economy, including closing the gap and providing some more support to local businesses that we are very concerned about are going to struggle economically over the next period of time during the recovery.
Well, thank you very much, Lieutenant Governor. Minister Kaag, what's your view on this?
Yeah, well, it's less of a view, but I think first a set of measures and decisions we've taken, and of course, I'm a big proponent and a supporter of. First of all, of course, we've looked at the domestic refinancing and shoring up package. I think most governments, certainly in the OECD, have followed the same prescript. Bridging loans, extension of payments, assistance with rents, salaries, the substitution effect, but that's the holding pattern. What we've done, given the fact that we are a trading nation and one third of our jobs in the Netherlands are created by foreign trade within the EU, with the EU and outside, we've eased measures on export credit insurance through the funding mechanisms that I have, such as the Dutch Trade and Investment Fund and the Dutch Good Growth Fund. They're two different funds. We have created additional opportunities to provide working capital and payment repayment terms were eased. All these are quite important as the immediate quick fix. Now, if we're looking at the service provision and, of course, also the enabling environment that we as a government need to provide, we've established a little bit like California emergency help desks that really work around the clock to answer questions from entrepreneurs, Dutch ones and internationals in trouble, to help them where to go, to find out where the assistance is most effective to deal with the issues in question. Our network, of course, of embassies, consulate general and other offices have sort of created digital services desks like webinars to ensure that once we could restart the conversation, this is happening. It's happened in Africa, on the continent. It's happened in many different countries, different measures. It's tailor-made, but I think that's a sign of confidence. And we're looking at financing additional studies for into promising markets as a restart. We've established and expanded the coaching and networking and training programs for entrepreneurs, not just the ones that venture out into the international market for the first time, but also those that need to reboot, reset. There's a wide set of skills training programs available. Of course, this one, the Organizational Digital Trade Missions, sectorially and country by country. So again, we sort of look for the best way to articulate the program, and then of course to have the right delegation to be fit for purpose. And I think actually digitally, of course, creates a wider space of opportunities. It's low cost once we know how to do it. We can help business meet other businesses without the upfront investment. And there's a bigger role, I believe, for embassies and other partners. And we are expanding the digital service to Dutch entrepreneurs when they need to have the information to establish the profiles, and of course to provide for, I would say, almost more hands-on networking done by a government than we've been able or have been asked to do for quite some time. The next round, as a government, we're looking, of course, at what we call sort of the third package of emergency / restart and economic recovery measures. In that space, we're looking as well at additional financing to really pick up the international trade agenda. But of course, there's also a duty of care by all of our entrepreneurs, be they startups, scale-ups, or long-established companies, that we're really asking them also to look at the responsibility they have within the chain to give back. So this is not applicable to Silicon Valley or the Netherlands and the state of California, but it's highly applicable to companies, for instance, in the textile sector that work in Bangladesh, that where orders are cancelled and jobs are no longer secure for the daily workers. So it depends on the country and the issue in hand. We will tailor our service, our backup support, but we're also asking entrepreneurs to sort of take their responsibility as a shareholder in the entire chain. And I think that's the big question when we're looking at global trade as well, and the viability politically of global trade when it comes to the sensitive issues and the downsides of globalization. Fair and living wage, labor conditions, insurance, how we can move forward in order to actually sort of shore up stability and therefore also these chances of economic recovery. That's a broader question, but it's important that we all consider this. And I know that in Silicon Valley, there is a sort of a forward-looking team, the lieutenant governor, but also the state itself. The DNA of California seems to be all centered around sustainability and equality and issues of equity. And I think that's an important question we all need to continue to debate and discuss and find ways out of this crisis.
Well, thank you very much. And I would like to continue with a question of one of the participants of this digital trade mission. We have 80 Dutch entrepreneurs and about 40 US counterparts. So I'm very pleased that we have as well an interactive platform where people can engage and come to matches. And matchmaking, of course, is always very important, even in a virtual trade mission. And the question is from Huib Stad. He was actually in the loop just before our opening session. He's founder of Roding City. And he's asking the question, if you, and I would like to start with you, Minister Kaag, if you had a magic wand, which of California's strength would you like to immediately become reality in the Netherlands? And I'll come back to you, Lieutenant Governor, to ask you the same question.
Oh, it's a tough one. Well, I would say many, but of course, you all remember the famous film, Country A First, and Could We Be Second, and vice versa. I think we all look up to California for its innovative ability, its innovative ecosystem. We have something similar in the Netherlands, and we work and invest around the triple helix, as you know, Huib, which is very much the intersection between government or the public sector, private sector, and the knowledge institutions. But I think the way California has taken this to scale, when it comes to innovation and really have the power and investment drive of the private sector with the universities and then sort of take to market what you've researched, you've designed it, and you're ready to implement and roll with it, basically, that's something we could probably try to copy even better. And there's, of course, a call on ourselves to do that. But maybe, yeah, I think that's what it is. Seems to be California's DNA. But I'm saying, as a Dutch person, we are renowned all over the world as the can-do people, and with that tremendous sense of entrepreneurship and risk-taking in a sensible way. So I think that the partnership is a strong one. And I know a lot of the knowledge institutions, our universities, who rank top of the world and at a low fee, but top of the world in terms of performance and educational standards, we have a lot to gain, particularly in sharing. And I think this is really where the strength of the Netherlands also comes from, our ability to co-create and to work with others for the optimal outcome and the best result. And we have little pride in this game, and that can be an asset in addition to our bluntness.
Thank you. Thank you. Lieutenant Governor, what Dutch strength would you like to incorporate in California?
You know, I have been to Holland. It's incredibly beautiful, and my mind is kind of swirling and honestly, I think about so many things where Holland has been a leader, but I can't help, as someone who served as an ambassador in Budapest, Hungary, to think of your leadership, sort of draw back the lens and think about the way that Europe has addressed the issue of climate and how much, even though there's plenty of diversity of thinking of many things in Europe, that when it comes to sustainability, when it comes to diversifying into sustainable energy, over many years, Europe really has been a leader, and the Netherlands has played a very important part of that. So we in the United States, California is working very hard to lead in the country. But as you know, on a federal level, our policies are diametrically opposed right now. The federal government is directing itself outside away from Paris, and as California is working hard to make up for that. So I guess what I would like is to be as successful as Holland is in your voice in Europe. If California can be more successful in our country in helping the rest of the United States learn and understand how incredibly important it is to address climate, to move toward more sustainable fuels in our country, and how important that is for our position in working as Holland has to lead, not just within the governments around us, but in the world.
Thank you. I wish I could give you both this magic wand, but I think that our partnership will lead to the success. And I have a final question.
We may not need a magic wand. We do have an election coming up.
Well, I have a final question. I think I'll build a bit on what has already been said by Minister Kaag. Academia play a very important role. We have a question from Anoushka Versleijen. She's program manager at Technical University Delft. And Anoushka is asking the question, academia, they play a very important role, both in California's and the Dutch economy, supporting an innovative edge and competitiveness. Could you please elaborate on the collaboration between government and research institutes in the field of smart and e-mobility? And perhaps, Lieutenant Koenelakis, Lieutenant Governor, you would like to start with this question.
Sure, I'm happy to do that. I mean, this is a sweet spot for me. I sit on the board of the University of California. In fact, we have a special meeting that's going on, and I'll be toggling back and forth between that meeting and this morning. I also serve as a member of the trustees of the California State University System. So we are extremely proud of our system of higher education in the state of California. And I think that whenever you hear any official in our state talking about what were the conditions that created Silicon Valley in the first place, it is the combination between federal investment in innovation through our university systems, the flexibility within our university systems to partner with the private sector, and then the availability of venture capital around those systems to have what we call tech transfer. So this has been at the core of the creation of Silicon Valley and the success of California in the innovation space. So let me just say a few words about our system of higher education. We are, according to US News and World Report, home to half of the top 10 universities in the United States are here in California. We are home to two of the top 5 universities in the world. California is also home to 4 national laboratories, the Lawrence Berkeley National Laboratory, Lawrence Livermore, the Sandia National Laboratory, and the SLAC National Accelerator Laboratory. We are the recipient of about $3 billion a year in NIH funding to California universities, to absolute, you know, extraordinary amount of federal funding that comes in to our universities to fund research. We have a system of community colleges whereby, and I, again, this is important and extraordinary in the U.S., though you're no stranger to public funding of higher education. But the first 2 years of community college is free for Californians. So we are extremely proud of what we provide Californians, and we have all total about 3 million students currently enrolled in public higher education in our state. So this is very important. It is also a draw for the best and the brightest from around the world. As a result of educational opportunities in our state, we have now become, I believe that's a very important part of it, but also economic opportunity. We are now 27% foreign-born in the state of California. So it is a very robust educational environment. And there are there was an investment in linkages so that university professors are not just invested in for the research they do. They are surrounded by the most robust environment for venture capital funding and encouraged to both be in research and development in the university system, even in the public university system, and working with the private sector to transfer those innovations into the kinds of companies that can bring those developments to the market. So all of that together has created a very robust environment. And it's something that we not only will continue to do in this state, but we very actively work to champion this kind of model in the world. Because as we know, there are countries that have incredible university systems, but there are barriers sometimes for that kind of innovation to make its way into the commercial sector.
Thank you very much, Lieutenant Governor. Minister Kaag, what is your response? And perhaps you would also like to add a short concluding remark, because I think we are almost at the end of this session. I know you have a busy schedule, so I'm very pleased that you were able to join us in this opening session. Minister Kaag, the floor is yours.
Yeah, thank you very much. Now, indeed, the moment I conclude, I'm going to have to excuse myself, Lieutenant Governor. Like you, I'm expected at a cabinet meeting, which has started. So I'll be very brief. And I think I very much recognize the system that you described. In the Netherlands, we pride ourselves on the triple helix, what I described before, government research institutions and the private sector, certainly on all the global challenges that require a multidisciplinary approach, require investments, required application, required taking to scale. It's only in this way we feel we can actually make headway and make progress. Also, as a country that is small in geography, but I believe big in terms of economy, we're the 17th economy in the world. And of course, we are a thought leader in many fields, and we host centers of excellence. Our universities, Delft, Twente, Technical University of Eindhoven, and of course, we have the TNO, the Dutch Public-Private Organization of Applied Research, and many other partners in this regard. So all issues of energy, climate, safety, it really rests on the solutions and the partnerships these entities have, often also within Europe, with European counterparts or partners, and of course, twinning in the relations that researchers may have or faculties, technical faculties will have with the renowned universities, also, of course, in California. So I think there's a natural ecosystem that has evolved. I think the current era we live in has only underpinned that we need to work together. We can't compete around the same scarce resources. We need to foster the collaborative environment where knowledge and resources are shared in a way that we can find these solutions to global challenges. And I think this is the vaccine, the quest for the vaccine against to protect us from COVID-19 is a critical and essential example, I think, of that new era in which we really need to work this way. On smart and on smart and e-mobility, we have many funding programs, for instance, that sort of that will allow partners to provide proof of concept. But the Netherlands is a country of low lands that get flooded every year traditionally by water, the rising levels of the canals, and of course the rivers. And it's because of this shared challenge at village level historically. We have worked and we've always negotiated and built partnerships from village, community, village to city. And it's called the Polder model. And it's a collaborative platform of the different partners. And I think this is the way we work. We'll always keep on working. Our universities are not necessarily in the top 10, but they're always in the Times and other international educational supplements, top 100, most of them, if not all. They're all state funded, no private universities. The fees are very moderate and modest compared to American universities, whichever way you spin it. Taxpayers pay for this. And we believe indeed that a high quality public education system is the best way to invest in human well-being and the potential of every citizen in the Netherlands, but open to others to come and sort of share the benefits, but of course also help us gain progress or achieve progress with their knowledge. And that young generation of young international students, I think, is formidable, very important. It not only keeps us honest, but it helps us break through all the other barriers. Diversity of thought is as important as diversity of the presence of the different people, not only their cultures, language, and experiences, but it's also the diversity of thought. And I hope together we will continue to achieve that. State of California under your leadership, and of course ourselves as the Kingdom of the Netherlands. Thank you very much. I really have to run before they close the door.
Thank you so
wonderful
much.
To
thank
see
you both,
Madam Minister,
for your participation. Thank you, Minister Kaag. Thank you,
thank
Lieutenant
you.
Governor Kounalakis. I'll give back to Sietse, and I thank you very much.
Thank you, Gerbert. And this ends the opening session of the first Dutch virtual trade mission.
And this ends the opening session of the first Dutch virtual trade mission. And just like in a Zoom meeting, you have to turn on your mic. For the participants, shortly after this, my colleague Deborah will give you a brief introduction of the online platform, so you will find out all the features that are available. And I'll repeat it again. If you would like to post about this on social media, please do use the hashtag NLUSA or hashtag Digitale Missie and tag us as the consulate. At NL in SF. That's it for now. See you at the instruction video and everybody following us through Facebook Live. Thank you for joining and see you next time.